Good morning, everybody.
Morning.
It's a privilege to be here with you this morning. So good to see your faces, hear your voices, and be able to share with you our fellowship together. There's just something about being together. It's so good to be back, and we don't want to take a day for granted. We're here today, and God's given us this place to meet, and let's celebrate that. And the songs we're singing this morning are so powerful, especially this first one, Amazing Grace. And it's a reminder of who He is and that unmerited favor that He gives to you and to me. So much to celebrate. We have a special speaker today, and Nagy's here. And she's going to share with us about being a missionary and hopefully maybe challenge us just a little bit. And I really appreciate Anne's willingness to be here and speak today. And she's going to share with you some pictures and things about the mission there where she serves. I want you to stand with me if you would, and let me pray with you this morning. Heavenly Father, it's just overwhelming when we really think about your grace. We certainly don't deserve it, and you're a God who initiates the relationship that we have with you, and we're so grateful. Without that, we are lost and undone and hopeless. Thank you, Lord, for being the God that you are, and for being personal, loving, and gracious. Father, I pray as we sing these songs of worship together, and as Anne shares what you've laid on her heart, that we would open our hearts and minds to hear and receive and to follow in your will and your way. Lord, I pray that you would get us out of the way, the flesh, and fill us with your spirit and with your compassion, your character, your nature. And Father, I pray that Homewood Baptist Church and all those listening or watching elsewhere would be filled with you, and we would be lights and beacons in this world that we live. Lord, thank you for this time. In Jesus' name, amen. Sing along with us as we sing.
Grace that's all.
shall soon be all like snow. The sun for man to shine.
Jesus have mercy.
seated if you would. Good singing, good words. The last part of that song said, I'll never, no, never, no, never forsake. And you'll understand this later, but if we change that word to pit, it might be a proclamation that we might need to make in the day we live in. I'll never, no, never, no, never pit it. That soul, though all hell should endeavor to shake, I'll never, no, never, no, never pit it. I'll explain it later. At least you got the word you need, okay? All right. Thank you so much for being here, and we have gathered to worship the Lord, and it's good to see you and spend time with you as always, and don't want to take that for granted. It's not something that we're guaranteed every day. We're not. And the Lord has certainly blessed us today with His presence and our time here together. I want to share a couple announcements with you and some updates. And I don't know if you got the mass announcement or not. And by the way, I made a mass announcement this week that has yet to go out. Don't know when it'll show up, okay? But you know that. So if it's 3 or 4 in the morning, just pray for me and go on, okay? Don't know where it is. It just vanished out there somewhere. But this Saturday from 8 to 12, we have a spring clean giveaway, okay? Is that the right thing? I say it right? Spring clean giveaway out here. And it's for our community, okay? It's for our community. And part of that mass announcement that's out there somewhere, I have reminded you that room 207, big class back here on the adult wing over this side, is going to be used, or is being used, as a staging area. So people have already started bringing stuff, and you can put it in that room. Now remember, there's a catch, okay? If you bring stuff, we expect to see you Saturday, and the ministry there is going to be active and real and needed. And after it's over, if your stuff is still there, we want you to take it back, okay? It's not coming back in this building, okay? Take it back. The other thing is, what's most important is we're ministering to our community. It's not really about the stuff. It's about being able to fellowship with them and connect and speak to them and just get to know them a little bit and see about their families and what's going on in their lives. One thing about the pandemic, or however you want to label it, it's kind of put everybody in the same boat, okay? So everybody's had a really, really tough last 13 months. So please come. You don't have to know anything about yard selling or anything like that, but just come and get to know some folks and speak to the folks and just kind of help them with stuff. You might want to help them carry stuff to the car or whatever, but just so they'll know we're here, we want to know about you, we love you, and most importantly, God loves you. And that's what Saturday's about. This is for everybody. This is for our congregation as a whole to participate in. All right, this is my little soapbox here. I think it'd be great for us to have a swap meet between ourselves at some point later on in the year. But this ain't it, okay? So don't be picking through the stuff and putting it in your car. This is for our community. Now you know I'm speaking the truth, don't you? I need one. No, you don't. Believe it. This is for our community. So I know what you're saying. I do the same thing. I say, hey, I haven't seen one of those in a while. I'll put that in. No, you won't.
But if it's left over, they can take it.
If it's left over, they're going to take it. Yes, ma'am. Absolutely. All right. So please keep that in mind. Pray about it. We are long past the days of putting a sign out saying, y'all come, and people come inside this building. Our community, our world, it has nothing to do with that. We need to be out there where they are. And even though it's only a few feet from inside here, at least it's outside, and our community will come. Please show up Saturday morning from 8 to 12. You don't have to stay the whole time. You don't have to come at 8. You can come later. But please participate. It's one of those great opportunities we have to fellowship and spend time with our neighbors. Lord willing, you'll get a mass announcement about this sometime this week, okay? Just telling you, it's a possibility. Don't know what time, but it'll show up sometime. Please note the things in your bulletin, upcoming events, and that's our big one for this week. We are back in the building, as you see here, for Sunday school and so forth. And this Wednesday, we're also going to add Teen Kid, and I will be and here on Wednesday instead of in the office with Facebook. We're still going to do Facebook and YouTube, but I will be here. You're welcome to come if you'd like to on Wednesdays, or you can still watch on Facebook or get it on YouTube later. But that's opening up this Wednesday. Teen Kid will meet this Wednesday at 6:30. Our Sunday schools, classes, small groups are meeting. Children are back there. And adults are met. I've met. It's just thank you for getting back in the swing of things. And sometimes we're a little rusty. We hadn't been, you know, we hadn't done this in a while. So it's so good to hear voices and see people walk in and out and participate. Birthdays, we have birthdays. Next Sunday, Johnson Edition will be here. Their brothers and sisters, there's information there in the bulletin about them. And you've heard them before. They're singing at Myrtle Beach at Singing in the Sun. They're sharing down there all week, I think. I don't know when that starts. Do you all know? Anyway, they're there all week, and then they're coming here. So they just have a great spirit about them and disposition and great talent. So I plan on coming and bring people, invite people to come. And I'll introduce Ann in a little bit, and it's so great to have her here. And I'll share with you a little bit about that later on. And we're going to make sure you note the praises, prayer concerns in the back of your bulletin. We try to add those during the week, add to those. On Wednesday night, refreshed Bible study. We usually get more prayer concerns to add to the list. As an update, Doris, is she in here or is she back there? She's back there with children. Okay. Cameron Harrington, Doris's son, has been going through quite a lot the last several weeks with pneumonia and different things. He has had a procedure in the hospital. He'll be there probably till Friday, unless the Lord has something different, which, you know, he usually does, but that's what the doctors are saying. He's doing better. Pray for Cameron and his family, and also Steve Mincy. Steve Mincy had quadruple bypass this week, and he is doing well. He made several laps around the place yesterday. Day before, he was really not looking forward to what was coming next. But yesterday, he's scooting. And you know, if you've had that surgery or anything close to that, they don't let you lay there for very long. But pray for Steve and his family. And so anyway, and our other prayer concerns and those that have procedures or are going through different things with their physical body and as well as mental and spiritual and emotional things going on. Yes, ma'am.
David and not Larry. I'm on the back.
David.
My brother David.
Oh. David and not Larry. Okay. David. On the prayer concerns, please change that to David. Forward. Thank you, Barbara. Thank you. All right. Any other changes I need to make or anything else on there? Need to update?
Dave.
Yes, ma'am. Surgery May the 26th, Michelle. All right. We'll be praying for you, Michelle. 26th of May. Okay. Thank you, Michelle.
You're welcome.
All right. We're going to give the Lord tithes and offerings. And thank you. Thank you for continuing to be faithful in that. Tithes and offerings. And there's just something that God just takes care of things when we trust Him with the thing that we hold on to the tightest. And a lot of times that's our finances. We're going to give our tithes and offerings this morning, so I'd like to ask the ushers if they come forward, and we're going to do that. And sometimes when we have a special guest, we take up a love offering. Today we're going to give Miss Anna a check out of a budget, our budget ministry line item. If you want to contribute further to that, you can talk to Ann. Anyway, you'll hear more about our ministry later, but let me pray with you. Heavenly Father, thank you so much for your goodness and grace, and thank you for providing for us every single moment of every day. And may our tithes and offerings be a sign of trust and faith in you and obedience. And I pray that you be honored and glorified in Jesus' name. Amen. this morning, some older pictures, aren't they? Way back when. Sometimes it's good for us just to be reminded of where we came from and what happened several years ago, and see family members and children that are now adults and have children of their own. Anyway, I appreciate Doris got these pictures together. Several of you have gotten pictures together over the last couple of years. I'm trying to get those before you, just so you can see the life of Homewood over the years. I had a privilege a couple days ago to meet Anne and talk with her briefly. And we talk about missionaries a lot. We talk about being missionaries a lot. And it has been our privilege to have a young lady from South Asia to come visit us last year, I believe it was. Was that last year? Things are kind of foggy these days. And we talk about the local missions and North American missions. Anne is an international missionary, and she's here. And in town, Mom lives here in Conway, and she's been on the mission field for 12 years, or over 12 years. She's going to tell you more about those details. I want you to hear from her heart and her mind. I really appreciate her being here and taking time to share with us what it is like to be there. And for us to, not just to see someone on the screen that's on the video that we were sent, which is perfectly fine, but to have a face and a personality and to see someone who is personally not just serving every once in a while, but that's her life. And what that means to you and me as well. And I won't put words in her mouth. I'll let her share with you. But I want to read this to you from Acts 13. Now there were at Antioch in the church that was there prophets and teachers, Barnabas, Simeon, who was called Niger, and Lucius of Cyrene, and Manian, who had been brought up with Herod the Tetrarch, and Saul. And while they were ministering to the Lord and fasting, the Holy Spirit said, "Set apart for me Barnabas and Saul, for the work to which I have called them." Then when they had fasted and prayed and laid hands on them, they sent them away. This is the record of the first missionary journey that we have record in Scripture, and it's gone from there. And you know, we've shared this even recently, Great Commission, Jesus says, as you're going through this life, make disciples. And that's to every believer. So what is missions, and what does it look like in our lives and everybody else's life? And I just appreciate Anne being here, and I want you to listen carefully to what she's saying and the pictures that she's showing you. Anne, thank you for coming and sharing with us. Would you welcome in Nagy.
Good morning, Homewood Baptist Church. It's an honor to be here this morning. As a missionary representative of the IMB, and as the Southern Baptist Churches give to the Lottie New Christmas offering, is what helps to keep us on the field. So we want to say thank you. And I'll start with giving a little background, and then we'll go through the slideshow. So as Pastor Steve said, I've been with the IMB for 12 years now, serving in Bangkok, Thailand. I was a student at Liberty University in college. I graduated from Liberty University in Lynchburg, Virginia. And while I was at Liberty, actually that's where the Lord called me to missions. When I was at Liberty, I went on trips to India, Africa, Slovakia, many places in the world, and I felt the calling when I was in college. I majored in education to be an elementary teacher, and so when I graduated from Liberty, I first went to India for 4 months to serve as teaching at an orphanage there, and then I returned back to the States, and I began teaching in the public schools in the Lynchburg, Roanoke, Virginia area. And I taught for a few years, and then I went overseas to Slovakia and taught in a village there for a year. Then I came back to the States and taught again at the public schools in Virginia. And then as I was nearing 30 and still single, I said, okay, Lord, you called me when I was in college to full-time missions, and so I'm going to trust the Lord in that and answer that call. And so I applied to the International Mission Board, and very quickly the Lord opened the door, and within a year I was on the field. So many people ask me, why did you choose Bangkok, Thailand? So along with the call to missions, I really had a call to work with university students. My heart was I wanted to work with university students because they are the future, the impact that's going to come in the future. And so as I was looking through the jobs with the International Mission Board, Bangkok, Thailand was drawn out to me because there were 1 million university students in the city of Bangkok, the capital city. And some of the other choices that I had, one in Africa, one in Europe, didn't even have 1 million people in the whole city, much less the university population. So I decided and prayed through it, and the Lord sent me to Bangkok, Thailand in 2009. So January of 2009, I arrived there. And originally, my plan with the International Mission Board is I committed to 2 years. And so that was my original commitment. And as you can see, 12 years later, I'm still there. So God has different plans than we have, but I'm thankful for his plans and that they're perfect. So I'm going to show you a few a little bit at the beginning. This is the city of Bangkok. So Bangkok has a little over 15 million people. So it is a very modern city, very urban, up to date, lots of public transportation, sky train system, subway system, and a main river thoroughfare that runs through that is the Chao Phraya River. Okay. It is also a Buddhist country. So Thailand is 95% Buddhist. So to give you a little bit of background, I'm not sure how much you know about Buddhism. So that is the primary religion, with the second one being Islam, only a small percent, and Christian makes up only 1% of the Thai population. Thai people are very friendly. It's known as the land of smiles. So you will see lots of smiling people around. These are some monks that relate to Buddhism. And it is part of, to be Thai is to be Buddhist. So it's part of their identity. It's on their identity cards that they carry around with them. So like our driver's license or our ID here in America, we don't have anything on there that says religion, but in Thailand they do. And so it's actually Buddhist is written right on their ID card. It's a part of their identity. And they are a very community-oriented culture. So they don't make too many decisions individually. Most of the things that they do are community. The advantage, though, in Bangkok is, in Thailand, is Thailand is an open country. So it's one of the few countries in Southeast Asia, in that part of the world, that allows missionaries to be there. So I actually can be a missionary in Thailand and say I'm a missionary. So I don't have to hide it. I can go out and I can share with people. So Thailand is a very open country, but the soil is very hard, with only 1% being Christian. So we have multiple IMB missionaries that live in the city of Bangkok with focus on lots of different ministries. We have some that work in the red light district with women in prostitution, women who have been trafficked. We have missionaries who work with the Thai pastors in biblical training, theological training. We have people that work with refugees, some that work with focus on Chinese, some that work with Burmese. And my focus is on Thai people and university students. And so this place, you can kind of see the tall building in the background. That is actually my apartment building. That's where I live. I live on the 9th floor across from the university, one of the universities that I focus a lot of my work on. And I wanted you to see, this is what the traffic is like on the road that I live on. And so this is why most of the time I live close to the university, so I can walk there, because it's much faster to walk than to go. And in Bangkok, it is traffic jams are something that you're going to find everywhere. So often it's better to use the underground subway or the above ground SkyTrain system if you can. Okay. So this is the university, Kasetsa, one of the universities where I focus on. And I teach small groups. English, but most of the things that I teach them English are using Bible stories. So I use Bible stories and different things to teach them English. So usually my small groups are 10 students or less. So here's kind of some of the different pictures of the students. Some of them come from all different faculties, engineering, education, all different majors. Okay, and as I'm teaching the students, I'm looking for students who are seekers, who want to know more. Most of these students have never heard the gospel, or they've at least never heard the complete gospel. And so this is an example. This young lady in this picture, she is actually one that was a seeker in her group. When I first started teaching and we did Bible stories, she said, "I've always wanted to know about the Bible, and I've never met anyone to teach me." And so each week, I would sit down with her one-on-one and study Bible stories specifically just with her. So those are the kind of students we're seeking out. So along with students, in the building where I have my classroom, the maids have also come to study some English. And so in this example, the lady standing, she's a Thai believer, and she is sharing with the four maids here the gospel using a flip chart, like a picture chart. So three of these are professors that teach at the university that come and study with me. And this is a picture group of faculty secretaries, administration people who come. So not just students, but maids, professors, different people who work at the university come and study English with me, and it gives me an opportunity to share the gospel with each and every one of them. So along with teaching, I also have like outreach events. So every month we'll have some kind of outreach event at the university. So usually some kind of party. This is an example of students who come to an event. Most of the time they love when you have food, just like America or anywhere else. If you have a pizza party, students come. So here's an example of we had a pizza party and a group of students came for outreach. And when we have these outreach events, other missionaries will help me. But one of the keys is inviting the Thai believers to be a part of the event. So the Thai believers from the Thai church will come in, spend time with the students, talk to them, and have opportunities to share their testimony and to share the gospel with them. So here's just some different pictures from different events that we've had. One event, I taught them how to make Rice Krispie treats. They thought that was the most wonderful thing ever. To learn how to make them, and actually that whole pan right there that little group made, they ate them all right within probably 20 minutes. So that's kind of some pictures. That's my classroom that I teach in, but we use the same room also for parties and events, so we set up the tables differently for events. And another way that these events are really helpful is when we have teams that come from America. So this is an example, a picture of we had a team from, I believe this group was from California, a Southern Baptist Church in California came. And when we advertise for some people from Americans are coming, you can come and practice, lots of students come. It's a big draw. And so here's another example. A group came from North Carolina, from Southern Baptist churches, and we had another big event. So often when church teams come, we have big events and things that will draw the students in. And this is an example at this same event, the big one that we have the picture in. As part of that, we have little centers. So they went around from different groups to the different activities doing different things. And some of them are just English games. They might have played bingo or different. But at this particular one, he has a creation to Christ flip chart there, and he's telling them the story of creation to Christ. So that's one of the centers that the students will travel around to hear the gospel. Here's some more pictures of another team that came from Alabama. And we also have some Muslim students, so we have some opportunities to go to the Muslim club and to reach out with them also. And this is another in the Faculty of Science. This was a building. We had a team come, and they opened the opportunity for us to come for the day to do in the science department to do a like English for the day. So I took a missions team with me, and we had a big one-day event in the Faculty of Science teaching English and having opportunities to build relationships. So these are still the students as they're graduating. Those are actually the same guys who were in the eating the Rice Krispie treats that we were making, so they graduated. So some of them from that. So along with this picture is actually in my apartment across from the university. So some of the students, I also invite them to come into my home, the seekers, and sometimes I teach them how to cook something, how to do something, and then we study Bible stories. So this is a picture of us studying Bible stories in my apartment. This is a Saturday trip. We went on a train trip, so we often also go on outreach events somewhere in the community. So we take the students on a one-day trip somewhere. Maybe it's a whole day of traveling to go somewhere to do. This is an English camp that we have. We invite the students to come for an English camp for the weekend. And we, again, have Thai believers and other American believers there to have opportunities to share the gospel with the students. This is at a Thai church camp, so every year the Thai church has a church camp. It's at a Thai church camp. And then also inviting the students, so these are a group of students from the university that I invited to the Thai church for Christmas. So a group of the students came to the church. Most of them, it's the first time they've ever stepped inside of a church. And so I invited them to come, and actually two of those students are Japanese exchange students that also came. So we had a group of students who come to the church. This is a group of the Thai believers there at the church. And this young lady, we're going to call her Jay, so she is a student, the one in the red sweater. She's a student at the university, and I invited her and some of her friends to come to some of the events at the Thai church. And this was, we were coming home from Valentine's Sunday. We were riding the bus together back to the apartment area where the university is. And she was sitting next to me and she said, "I think I'm ready to follow Christ." And I remember I was totally shocked and I looked at her and I felt like I was trying to talk her out of it. I said, "Are you sure? Are you really sure you understand?" So I said, "Okay, this week, please come to my apartment." And I had my Thai believer friend that came to, and I said, let's really make sure that Jay understands the gospel completely. And so we were sharing with her. Of course, all of this is done in Thai, in her heart language. And so sharing with her the gospel, and she said, "Yes, I am ready." And the next year she was baptized. So it's her in following in believer's baptism along with another young lady. And I'm going to tell you a few stories of baptism stories. So the lady in the middle, Elle, she has the striped shirt on. She's holding her niece, and her niece and nephew are on each side of her. So Elle became a believer first in her family, and she started coming to church every Sunday. And she started bringing first her niece and her nephew with her. And so her niece and her nephew both decided to follow Christ. And then not long after, her sister, which is the mother of the children, she started coming to church, and then she followed Christ. And so the mother and her two children were all baptized on the same Sunday at church together, so a family. The next one is also another family story. So you have M in the blue jacket. He became a believer first, and then he brought his sister, who was standing next to him, and then his sister came to Christ. And they were both coming to church every Sunday and really praying for their parents. And at a Christmas service, they invited their parents to come to church for Christmas, and they came. And not long after, their dad received Christ. And then it was probably another 4 months or so, and then their mom received Christ. So their mom, this is their mom's baptism. So she was the last one in the family to be baptized. So just another story of how through the son became one, his sister became one, his father then became one, and his mother became a believer. So then, in this last year in 2020, just like here, the pandemic hit, COVID hit, and everything in Thailand shut down. Okay, same like in America. So the university shut down, and the students went home. All of the malls shut down, all of the public, the restaurants shut down, everything closed. And in the first week or so, we were pretty much in lockdown. We were asked to stay in our place of living, except for just going out to get food quickly to take back home. We had a curfew. We needed to be in by 10 p.m. every night. No one was to be out past that time. And for the first week or so, I think I enjoyed the rest. I enjoyed being at home and finding other things. And then by the second week, I thought, oh, how long is this going to be where we're not going to be able to be out? And so I live across the street from the university, and the university was still open as far as the teachers, the professors were not there, the students had gone home, but I thought I can at least exercise around and do some prayer walking. So I went across the street and I'm walking around the university, which is a very big campus, and I'm just praying and asking the Lord, what am I going to be doing as the campus is closed down? We don't know when it's going to open again. And the campus is pretty much dead, except for I see a few like security guards around, and I saw some maids in the building sweeping and stuff, and the Lord just put in my heart, they need to hear the gospel too. And so I went back home and I thought, how can I reach out to these maids and to these security guards? I mean, obviously the outreach to the students is English is the draw. They want to learn English, and then through that I can share the gospel in English and Thai. But with these guards and these maids, everything's going to need to be done in Thai because they're not even interested really in learning English. And so we looked at the needs, and we made, the first week I made 20 bags. So 20 bags, as you can kind of see a little bit in the front, those are masks, and then we have like a Jesus book in Thai, and we put some snacks and foods and different things. And the first week we took 20 of them to the university, and it was myself and another IMB missionary and two Thai believers, and we walked around the campus to pass these out to the guards and to the maids. And as we gave them to them, we asked how we could pray for them, and we stopped right there and prayed for them. Well, as we were going around, I realized very quickly, maids and different people just kind of came out of everywhere, and I realized 20 bags were not going to be enough. And so the next week, we went back with 100 bags. And so we started going every week and giving out bags and even increasing in the bags what we put in them. Sometimes we'd have some rice or some noodles or some drinks. And then each week as we go, this is a group in a cafeteria, a group of maids that were working in that cafeteria, as we would go to give them the bags, we would tell them a story. And so this is a group of ladies gathering around listening to the Bible story as we're handing out. And again, most of them have never heard the story before. So each week we went back. And I'm going to focus mainly telling you about this guard who's in the white shirt there, who's pointing at the story. So I would tell them a story from the little flip chart. I would tell them a Bible story in Thai. And she was actually retelling the story to the other two maids. So she was retelling the story that I had told her because they had come in a little bit later. And so we're going to call the woman in the white shirt G. So G, she is in her 50s. She is a single mother. She has a son who is a university age student, and her parents, and she works 7 days a week at the university from 7 a.m. to 7 p.m. as a security guard, and lives in a small one-room apartment to collect money to send home to her parents and to her son that live about 2 hours outside of Bangkok. And the very first week that we went there and shared the story, I could see something different in G. Every time we shared a story, just her face, her demeanor, she was very engaged in the stories. And each week as we went back to tell a story, she would be able to retell all the stories I told her before. So by about week 8 or 9, she had 8 or 9 Bible stories that she could tell you. She would look at the picture and she could immediately tell you the whole story. And we had gotten to the story of Zacchaeus. We were on the week, we were telling the story of Zacchaeus. And she was getting teary-eyed. And she said, you know, I want to change like Zacchaeus did. I want to be different, but I just can't. Because I'm the only child. My parents are older. And, you know, part of Buddhism is they worship their ancestors. And so she's like, who will make offerings to my parents if I become a believer? And what would my parents think if I became a believer? And the next week, we did the story of Paul, and she cried even more. But she really could not come to follow Christ at this time. And so I asked you to pray for G, and there's a lot of G's in Thailand. She is one who, she says, I believe this to be the truth with my whole heart. And she could retell you story after story after story. But because of the commitment she feels to her family, to her parents, and that she is not willing to follow Christ, to make the decision to follow Christ, because she feels that it would affect her family members. And so I ask that you would pray for G and pray for the many others who are like that. The students, it's the same as we share with the students. They've never heard this before. It's exciting to them, but it's a big commitment to follow Christ, because it's almost like to leave your family. This is a map of Bangkok. So in Bangkok, it's separated into 50 districts. So in the 15 million people or plus that live in Bangkok, they're kind of divided into 50 districts. And so our goal as IMB missionaries is really that, is the future as we go forward, that in all of these 50 districts that we will have healthy, reproducing, gospel-sharing churches amongst the Thais. And so just to kind of look at that, there's a couple districts that I'm reaching out to with students, but it is a big task. And I want us to look at this, one of the Great Commission passages, Matthew 28, 19 through 20. And actually, I'm going to ask you guys if you'll read it with me. Okay, so let's read it together. Go, therefore, and make disciples of all the nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all things that I have commanded you. And behold, I am with you always, to the end of the age. Okay, so there's a couple words I have highlighted, and the first one is go. So as we look at go, now some people think, oh, go, this is the verse, this is the missionary verse. Well, guess what? This is, the Bible was written for all of us, so this verse is not just for me, it's for all of us. And go doesn't necessarily mean that you have to go across the world. Go is, you go to the place that you work, you go in your neighborhood, you go in your community. So anywhere that you go, each day you go and you share about Christ with others. So whether it's work, whether it's your neighborhood, whether it's at the grocery store, at the post office, whether it's at the outreach next Saturday that you're having for your community here, anywhere you go, that we're going to go and we're going to make disciples. And how do we make disciples? First, we have to share the gospel with them. And then after they become a believer, we want to help them to grow. And we want them to be baptized. And then we want them to teach them the truth from God's word and to help them to grow. And so these verses, I remember when I was a college student, and I always looked at this verse as like a missionary verse. It's for the missionaries, but really it's for all of us. And it doesn't mean that you have to go around the world. It means that we're just all called to go out and to be disciples and to make disciples. And it's a calling for all of us. It's not just for those who go overseas or who do even missions here in North America. We're all meant to be that. And so I want to encourage you all to each day as you go out, because we don't know when our last day on this earth will be. And so we want to make the most of each day in serving the Lord and being faithful and sharing with others. And some of you may wonder, so are you on furlough? Why are you here? So I'll explain a little bit of what my Conway connection is for some of you. So I actually was born in Michigan. I went to college in Liberty. And while I was at Liberty, my parents moved here to Conway, South Carolina. My dad had gotten a job at Coastal Carolina University. This was 24 years ago. So when I was in college at Liberty, and actually at that time, Liberty and Coastal Carolina were rivals. So where my dad was working and when I was going to school, we were rivals at first. They are no longer today. But so they moved here, and so I spent a few summers on my summer breaks at university. I spent a few of them here in Conway with them. And then, of course, like I said, I graduated from Liberty and stayed in Virginia, but I came back from time to time for holidays and things here to Conway. And once I went to the field 12 years ago, I spent a majority of my stateside time here in Conway to be with my parents. So I came back to Conway in August, at the end of August, planning to be here for about 1 month. I had actually taken vacation to come here at the end of August because my father's cancer had returned. So I came to spend time with them. And I'm still here 8 months later. But the Lord knew, because my father passed away at the end of December. And so I'm still here, but mainly because I wasn't able to get back in because of COVID. So The end of this month will mark 8 months I've been in the States. This is the longest I've been in the States in 12 years, so it's been a long time. But I'm thankful that the Lord gave me this time to be with my both my parents and then now with my mom. So, but in mid-January, the visa door opened again to return to Thailand. So I'm now in the process of doing the paperwork to be able to return to Bangkok. So hopefully, the process has been going on for a couple months now, and it's usually about a 2 to 3 month process. So I'm looking to be able to, if the Lord willing, that I'll be returning to the field next month in May or early June. So that is my plan for returning. But that is my Conway connection. So I hope that this is not the only time I'm going to be coming here to speak and to see you. I hope that as I come back for statesides every couple years, that I can come here and fellowship with you and be a part of the work that you're doing. And I'm going to be sending I'm giving one to Pastor Steve, and he'll share with you. We have a 30-day prayer guide coming out with this focus on Bangkok, on the work in Bangkok. There's 30 days. There's a virtual one where you can just look on at that, and then we'll actually have like paper copies that we'll give to the church. And so at the end of this month, those should be coming out in paper copy, but the virtual copy has already been produced. So you can look on and you can see. So when I talked about those 50 districts, each day, prayer day is focused on two of those districts. So it'll explain what the district is, what work is going on there. And each one also has a little video that will show a video of either a Thai person or an American missionary sharing a little, like a 30-second to 1 minute little thing, so you can meet even more IMB missionaries. But I thank you so much for the opportunity to come here today to Homewood and to speak to you. I thank you for your hearts, for giving to the Lottie Moon Christmas offering. As you give to that, it's what keeps all of us on the field, and only the Lord knows how many more years I'll be on the field, but I trust him right now. I feel a peace that I'm meant to return to the field, and so I'll be there as long as the Lord calls me to be there, and I'm just thankful for all that the Lord's done.
Amen. Amen.
Do y'all have any questions for Amy?
She don't get to go back, will we replace you with her?
Yeah.
And by the way, you can always come to visit, too. You can develop a team and come on over.
And will you be able to go back to your same apartment building?
Yes. Actually, the apartment that I lived in when I left is still has all my furniture and things in it, but actually the plan is by August I'll be moving to a different location.
Okay. Will you still go to that same university?
I still will, yes. And that one's just one of the several different ways that we do outreach on.
Any other questions?
You said on the IDs that they have Buddhists. If they do become Christians, does that need to change, or is that just something that's...
So when they change, that's up to the person. So when they like update their ID or something, yes, they can move it. And some people will change it. Now that's a really good question, because we had a young lady who became a believer as a university student. And she was scared to put Christian on her ID because she said, what if that keeps me from getting jobs? Because, you know, that's like on their application and things that, and so she was really, you know, not sure if she wanted to change that. So I would say there are probably some believers who don't change it for whatever reason, but yes, you can, when you redo it or you can go in and do it, you can have that change to Christian. That's a good question.
Just for curiosity, how does the lifestyle and incomes and careers relate over there to what we see here? I don't know, that's just a broad question.
No, that's okay. Actually, fairly similar. I mean, I would say in Thailand, they probably make a lot less, but the cost of living is a lot less. So I view it as it's probably about the same. I mean, most people like... You couldn't see it very close, but the apartment building that I live in is a pretty modern apartment that has a a swimming pool and whatever, and most of the people that would live in that type would be, you know, people who have a decent, you know, middle class to upper class would be the kind who would live in that kind of an apartment building. I mean, you have the poor, the very, you know, poverty in the areas, and then you have the very rich. So I would say it's fairly comparable. In Bangkok, there are probably, because it's the capital city, there are probably 30 shopping malls, and they are probably the nicest shopping malls you'll ever see. I mean, when my parents came there, they said, this is better than anything I've ever seen in America. So very modern in that way, in their style of living. But I would say the cost of living is less, so they make less. So often, Thai people, their dream is to come to America. And I keep telling them, even though you're going to make this much more money, it's going to cost this much more to live there. So really, it's equal. I mean, I would say that it'd be cheaper if you retired and went and lived in Thailand, your money would go a lot farther than what it would cost here.
The Christians, when they became Christians, are they prosecuted by their family, or just kind of they generally get accepted, or that all that changes from family to family?
It does change from family to family. In the Thai culture with Buddhism, it's not like what you might hear among Islam, like the Muslim where you hear about beating and different things. In the Buddhist and Thai culture, not so much of that, but a lot of, I would say, more emotional, meaning like if, let's say, one of their daughter or their son became a believer and they came home and they told their parents, they would say, oh, you don't love us anymore. We don't mean a lot to you. Well, who's going to do this? You know, kind of like how I was talking about the guard. I mean, she just feels like her parents will be devastated if she becomes a believer, because it means who's going to make offerings when they die? And so there's more of a sense of just, like a disappointment, or like, you don't love us, you don't. So there's a lot of that. Now, once in a while, you will get the ones who will be, you. If you want to be a believer, you have to get out of the house. You will see that once in a while, but it's more of emotional and just that you don't love us, you don't love your family, we don't mean as much to you.
Is it a safe country?
It is a very safe country, actually. It's very safe. Crime is very minimal.
And why do the college kids, because that's who you deal with mostly, why would they want to come to America, to leave that atmosphere and come to America?
I think what they see is the American dream, like on movies and whatever, wealth and, you know, and just the opportunities. I think they just view that America has all of this wealth and this wonderful, and that if they come here, they're going to be wealthy and they're going to have all of this. And so it's mainly a lot of what they see. You know, the hard part is you never want to, when you're sharing with Thai people, just be like, okay, I'm a Christian, and that be all. Because of all the TV shows and the movies that they see, they think those are Christians too. And so the lifestyle that they see on TV of the drinking and all of the promiscuity, all of that, they think that that's how Christians live. Because to be Thai is to be Buddhist. So they assume to be American is to be Christian. And so they assume and associate that all Christians live that kind of lifestyle. So you really quickly have to define what a Christian, and I almost use just a believer, a follower of Christ more so, because the term Christianity is used very generic. Thank you for having me.
It's an honor. I wanted to let you know how this is going to come to a conclusion today. Each Sunday, I try to leave you with the benediction that comes from Numbers chapter 6. And when we finish in just a moment, Anne has agreed to bless you with the same blessing, Numbers 6 in Thai. Sometimes we think God speaks English and that's it. He understands this prayer in any language. So I'm asking Anne if she'll do that. She's graciously agreed to do that. And before she does that, you'll see the words in Thai, or the symbols in Thai. We're going to sing a song to honor God. Before she does that, Worthy is the Lamb. And I mentioned this Wednesday night, and I didn't know where to put it in the service today, and I hesitated to do it at all. But as a matter of prayer, when we finish and after Ann says the benediction, I wanted to share briefly with you a letter that I received, everybody received from Billy Graham Churches as a matter of prayer. And I don't want to detract from what Ann has shared with us and what we need to take home from what we've heard today. But if you don't mind, after the blessing, if you could just hang around just for a couple seconds, I just want to read this as a matter of prayer for the church, okay? But right now we're going to sing, and after we sing, Anne is going to bless us with the blessing from number 6. So let's stand together.
Thank you for the cross, Lord.
this blessing and time. Ann, thank you so much for being here today. After the service, we want to talk to Ann and just bend her ear a little bit more if you need to. We really appreciate you coming. Ann.
I'm going to bless you in Numbers 6, 24 to 26 in Thai. Gandan wikti botiho koti yisitsi tung yisipo. Ko paja song amdwai papon da tan. La pitak raksa tan. Ko paja song hai papak kong praong. Ta sang da tan. La song pra garuna tan. Ko paja song nui papak kong praong nui tan. La patan sawadi pa da tan.
Amen. Thank you, Ann. Thank you so much.